I invite you to stand for the greeting. While all things were in quiet silence, and night was in the midst of her swift course, the Almighty Word, O Lord, leaped down out of thy royal throne.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, Christ is born.
The hymn is number 234. Beloved in Christ, we come by this service to prepare ourselves to hear again the message of the angels and to go in heart and in mind to Bethlehem and to see the loving kindness of our God and the babe lying in a manger. Let us therefore open the Holy Scriptures and read the earliest tale of that disobedience to God's holy will, which is common to us all, and then the story of the birth of Jesus Christ our Lord, to save us from our sins and make us pure and happy. And let us thank him with our carols of praise. But first, let us pray for the needs of this whole world, and especially for peace and goodwill among all people, that they may learn to love one another as children of one God and Father of all. And because this would most rejoice his heart, let us remember before him the poor, the helpless, the cold, the hungry, the oppressed, the sick and them that mourn, the lonely and the unloved, the aged and the little children, and all who know not the Lord Jesus, or who love him not, or who by sins have grieved his heart. Lastly, let us remember before God all those who rejoice with us, but upon another shore and in a greater light, that multitude no one can number, with whom in this Lord Jesus we evermore are one. These prayers and praises let us humbly offer to the throne of heaven in the words that Christ himself has taught us as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. In the spirit of Christmas family love and togetherness, I want to invite you to scrooge up so that you can tell whether your neighbor took a shower or not, to make room for our friends in the narthex. And are there any chairs left up here? There's one, two, three, four. There are four chairs up here. And do you all have enough hymnals so that every person has one to share? Do you need any hymnals up here? We're good? Good with the hymnals? All right. Got to take care of family, right? All right. That's lovely. It's a wonderful tradition at Duck Church that Amy and I do not take for granted, that we usually, I'm going to say always, get a call from the lay leader on Christmas Eve saying, John, I'm going to need just a moment to make a presentation. We never expect this, but we certainly do hope for it. And so, Scott Stewart, I invite you to come up, and Amy, I know Scott wants to speak to both of us.
Serve here in Duck as the lay leader, and my wife and I, who 25 years ago or so were looking for a church to grow with in our marriage and also with the family. So through all that, we found this church. It was a tiny little white church by the sea, and it has grown immensely, and with it, its faith and its hope and its love. So in doing that, I see that this church decorates traditionally each year, and how beautiful with the poinsettias and the tree, and it's beautiful. And with the windows and the sunset, what a gorgeous time of year, and especially to celebrate the birth of Christ. Fortunately, I was asked from the congregation to come up here and speak to you and to speak to the pastors about love. Again, as 1 Corinthians 13 states, faith, hope, and love. And within this church, there is so much faith. We have great hope, and what love here in Duck, in the community, and throughout the world. In that love, the congregation asked me to give them this love offering, which we traditionally do, and we might like to say Merry Christmas. And Happy New Year.
I speak on behalf of Amy and also her family and mine, thanking you for your generosity to us at Christmas and all through the year. Many of you from other places, you may be visiting in Duck for the first time tonight, but this congregation, it seeds itself in generosity and love to one another, to the pastors, and to the world. Thank you. God bless you. Would you stand for the reading of the gospel? And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one, into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, unto Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward all. And the shepherds said to one another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them, in her heart. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. We have now a message from Bishop Ward. I don't know if you've ever had the privilege of meeting Bishop Ward, but she is incredibly inspiring. The United Methodist Church is in ministry to people in need all over the world. One of our focus of ministry is Haiti, and in this message from Bishop Ward, you'll see a beautiful silver panel that was made by the people of Haiti for the North Carolina annual conference because of our ministry with them. You'll notice from what she says that the United Methodist Church has finished raising its $75 million for Imagine No Malaria to bring a gift of health to people all over the world, particularly in Africa. And now we are going to embark on a great mission to help children all over the world. She'll say a word about this.
Grace and peace to you in this joyous season of Advent. This beautiful Haitian Nativity panel is a representation of the shepherds startled by the heavenly host. The versions that we have used say they were sore afraid, or greatly afraid, or very startled by the angel's appearance. The angels sing of a child who is born and who lies in a manger, and they immediately leave their flocks and go and fall down to worship this child. Jesus Christ, in coming to us as a little child, thereby sanctifies all childhood in him. Those beautiful words coming to us from wise and gifted writer help us focus on children in our midst who bear the image of Christ. The United Methodist Church globally has a wonderful goal of reaching 10,000 children with life-saving interventions in the next quadrennium. Helping children have abundant life, what they need for health, mental health, spiritual health, physical health. In the North Carolina Annual Conference, we partner with the Western North Carolina Annual Conference in Congregations for Children. We are already committed to engaging with children in our communities. Thank you for being on the forefront of this movement to love children well and to help them wherever they are. We, like the shepherds long ago, continue to be awakened to God's great plan for us. In this season, we hear the singing of the angels. Rejoice, be glad. Indeed, we are.
In just a moment, we're going to receive the Christmas offering. I invite you to give as generously to God's work through Duck Church as you can. We put your gifts to the most amazing use. I invite you to see a quick collage of some of the ministry that we've been involved in this year, right here on the Outer Banks, in the state, and throughout the world.
us in his grace, his children evermore, his children evermore, evermore.
For this we raise a gladsome voice on high to thee alone, and evermore with thanks rejoice before thy glorious throne, before thy glorious throne.
Stand for the reading of the gospel lesson taken from Matthew chapter 2.
Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." When Herod the king heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, "In Bethlehem of Judea. For thus it is written by the prophet, 'And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel.'" Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the young child, and when ye have found him, bring me word again that I too may come and worship him." When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. And when they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeareth to Joseph in a dream, saying, "Arise, and take the young child and his mother, and flee into Egypt, and be thou there until I bring thee word. For Herod will seek the young child to destroy him." When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The hymn is number 238.
Thank you.
may be seated. Reciprocation is ingrained in us. The classic Christmas embarrassment is when someone gives you a gift and you didn't get them one. My grandmother used to buy extra gifts of cologne, lotions from Avon, candy, wrap it, put it under the Christmas tree, just in case somebody came by with a gift, she had something to reciprocate with. That reciprocation is really ingrained in us, isn't it? Do you watch The Middle? We do at our house. We watch The Middle. We sometimes watch reruns of it. We were watching the Christmas episode the other night, and Mike, who's the dad, one of the main characters, has a neighbor who brings him a surprise gift. And it's just priceless. You see Mike, he's a pretty good big guy. Mike is just standing in the doorway, and his friend hands him this gift. And Mike's just standing there, staring at him like, "You've got to be kidding me. We don't exchange gifts." He doesn't say any of this, really. But it's like, "We don't exchange gifts. You're standing here with a gift for me. We don't exchange gifts." And of course, the neighbor says, "Hi, Mike. It's good to see you, man. Merry Christmas. I was in the mall and I saw these sunglasses, and you're all the time squinting, and you don't have any sunglasses, so I thought I would get you these." Hands them to him. Mike's just standing there, staring at him. He finally takes him, says thanks, and shuts the door in his face. Now Mike is in the classic Christmas quandary. What do? Your neighbor gave you a gift, and the trouble is it's kind of an expensive gift, probably. The sunglasses look a little expensive. They don't look like he got them at the dollar store. What do? He doesn't know what to do. And this business of reciprocation is, I don't know, it's just too heavy for Mike to deal with. So he marches over to his neighbor's house. He knocks on the door. The neighbor answers the door, all smiles. "Hey, Mike, you like your new sunglasses? How much?" "What do you mean, how much? How much did you pay for the sunglasses?" "They're a gift, Mike." "How much? How much did you pay? With tax?" The neighbor tells him. Mike pulls out his wallet, gives him the money, and says, "We're even." Puts on his sunglasses, gets on his motorcycle, and drives away. Now, you and I both know that this is wrong. Right? What Mike was supposed to do is reciprocate. But he can't find it in himself to do that. So he just pays the debt of cash without addressing the debt of friendship. Love does this, doesn't it? It puts us under obligation. Sometimes that's a welcome debt with our spouses, parents, children, friends. Our lives are immeasurably enriched in the reciprocal relationship of an upward spiral. After all, last month at Thanksgiving, what were you most thankful for? Wasn't it the love of God, of friends, of family? Sure it was. The obligations of love are often welcome obligations, making life immeasurably sweeter and richer. And of course, sometimes love brings an unwelcome debt. Sometimes the needs or demands of the beloved are greater than we can manage. And that is difficult. how do we balance that? Sometimes those whom we love make inappropriate requests. One of the tricky things about love is that we have to draw delicate boundaries with those we love the most. Friends, spouse, children, parents. Because sometimes if we're not careful, the draw and pull of love can topple us, make us lose our balance or our identity. What happens when love wants only a hippopotamus for Christmas? And only a hippopotamus will do. Or when the love of your life starts sinking, Santa baby. And then we look at divine love, the love of God, the complete self-giving of God. It doesn't topple God or undermine God to give himself fully to us. Somehow, God gives from his strength, and the love of God triumphs over sin and death. The light shined in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Through the birth of his Son, God becomes flesh, lives among us, and immediately he is targeted for destruction by the political establishment. The wise men stop in Jerusalem to inquire, where is he who is born king of the Jews? Herod and the political establishment are afraid. And Herod immediately sends soldiers to Bethlehem to kill Jesus. God warns Joseph in a dream to flee. And so, Christmas sees the Holy Family, political refugees, escaping along the Silk Road to Cairo, traveling by foot and by donkey, the 225 miles, seeking the shelter of a neighboring country. Did you hear about the nativity play disaster over at First Church last week? It seems that 9-year-old William was supposed to be the hard-hearted innkeeper. And when the two kids playing Mary and Joseph came up asking if there was room in the inn, of course, he was supposed to say there wasn't any room, which he did. Everything was fine with the play, and everything was moving along as scripted until the holy couple, dejected and saddened, she heavy with child, the young innkeeper blurted out, "Wait, wait, you can stay at my house." And that's the spirit of Christmas. The love of God breaking boundaries between heaven and earth, between sin and righteousness, between life and death. The love of God which stoops to embody the weakest among us, the poor, the outcast, the feared, the refugee, and in so stooping, raises us to new life, new forgiveness, new love, and we are left wondering how to reciprocate. Amen. I invite you to turn in your hymnal to number 18 for the great Thanksgiving. Let us stand.
As
you look at the music on page 19, it looks very daunting, doesn't it? But as the angel said, fear not, I bring you good tidings of great joy. I'll sing a line, and you just sing the very same thing back after me. Deal? Okay. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
It is right that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto you, Almighty God. How much more on this night of night when we celebrate your ultimate self-giving to us. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord. God of power and might,
God of power and might,
heaven and earth are full of your glory,
heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, in the Lord Jesus, we remember how on the night that you were betrayed, you took bread, you blessed it, you broke it, and you gave it to your disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." Likewise, after supper, you took the cup, and when you had given thanks, you gave it to your disciples, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Christ will come again.
Pour out upon these gifts of bread and wine your Holy Spirit, that they may become for us the body and blood of Christ, and we may become the body of Christ for all the world. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
The body of Christ is broken for the sins of the world. The blood of Christ is poured out for the sins of the world. You may be seated. Let those who will assist with the communion come forward. you're invited to the sacrament of the Holy Communion. All who are in love and charity with your neighbor and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort. You'll approach from the center aisle with one palm on top of the other, like sinners begging for the grace of God, because that's what all of us are. As you approach the bread, it'll be placed in your hands with the words, "The body of Christ broken for you." You'll say, "Amen," or "Thanks be to God." You'll approach the cup. You'll hear the words, "The blood of Christ shed for you." You'll say, "Amen," or "Thanks be to God." Dip the bread ever so slightly into the cup. Eat, return to your seat by the center aisle. It will be crowded, but you will manage. I have faith in you. Come to the feast, for all is now ready. I invite you to sing the Christmas carols while we commune. Yeah. The body of Christ broken for you. 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 Matthew, is that right? The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. The 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 body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. Please turn into your bulletin for the prayer after communion. Let us pray. Almighty God, who has given us thy only begotten Son to take our nature upon him, and as at this time to be born of a pure virgin, grant that we, being regenerate and made thy children by adoption and grace, may daily be renewed by thy Holy Spirit, through the same our Lord Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the same Spirit, ever one God, world without end. Amen. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light.
The light shines in darkness, and the darkness has not overcome.
Those who dwell in the land of deep darkness, on them has the light shined.
We have beheld Christ's glory, glory as of the only begotten of the Father.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given.
In him was life, and the life was the light of all people.
We come now to the time for the candle lighting. We'll light the Christ candle, we'll light our candles, and then we'll bring the light to you. The ushers will come forth, their candles will be lit, and they'll light the candle of each person at the end of each row. You'll pass the light, but let me tell you how to do it, or you will get wax all over your clothes. The person with the candle that's lighted holds their candle still. The person with the unlighted candle brings their candle to the lighted one, and so on down the road. We have a tradition at Duck Church that the lights begin to go off as we're singing Silent Night. And then when we get to Joy to the World, we stand and we put our candles in the air. Join us. Thank you. child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, their great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord, Emmanuel. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace.